Well, I'm not rehearsed. It's okay.
It's very Quentin. Kind of silly, but
Quentin. We like him in Britain. We forgive him his self-indulgence.
Yes.
Pretty I'm much. A big admirer of the really of these American directors, because they, I just think, you know, European films are really arty, but American directors understand every single rule. They know, they understand the grammar. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, well, that's his obsession, clearly. He's like, and he does all the soundtracks.
But it's the same with the Coen brothers. I mean, you know, you can watch their films 1,000 times. It's like maths.
Yeah.
You know, it's that good.
There are very few like that. Kubrick was like that. I don't know if you consider him British or not.
Yeah, he was like that. Yeah, but I put him in the bag, you know, and also, you know, Scorsese for me. And it's whenever I make, I watch these films like obsessively and try and somehow use those rules when I make documentaries. But I mean, you can't do it in theory, but at least you can try and play that game.
So is that, as a documentarian, is that a key thing, is to try to make it more of a film and less of a documentary for you?
I think secretly all documentary filmmakers are very frustrated by the fact that reality doesn't conform to the rules of the film narrative, you know, and we get reality and we have to sort of attempt to package it up and follow follow the rules and package it up into a film narrative while still respecting the truth and what actually unfolds in real life, which is very rarely a three-act drama.
So in Google and the World Brain, you don't have a traditional following kind of element of the documentary. You have the story's been laid out over time, and you really are going back to report it more than.
I got 10 years in there, so it is a historical film, and I often do historical films, whether it's sort of recent history or ancient history. That's kind of what I deal with, historical periods. But you know, there are three acts there. Mm-hmm. And insofar as I could, I was trying to bend reality into this film narrative that would give you the imaginative engagement and the tension of a science fiction film.
And it is in some ways, like creating science fiction in some ways, isn't it?
What they're doing, yeah, it's a very science fiction idea, isn't it? To digitize every single book in the world and sort of create a sort of library in the sky. And I'd always wanted to film in libraries. That was one of the things that turned me onto this story. Huh. You know, you make a film about internet, how are you going to illustrate it? Nightmare. Mm-hmm. You know, it's all keyboards and wires and emails. And, you know, we've seen those fantastic close-up shots of people sort of pressing send, haven't we, and sort of Facebook the film and stuff like that. But like, I was like, how can I do it a bit different? And the book subject, okay, the library in the sky. Mm-hmm. Okay, let's find a couple of really futuristic libraries. And then when we're there, let's try and shoot them with a big crane. Let's spend our money, shoot it with a big crane, and not let people ever see the ground. So maybe if I'm really, really lucky, people are going to sort of think they're watching a science fiction film, and it's a bit like the camera's swooping past a spaceship full of books. You know, I try and get this sort of imaginative backstory going in the film. I don't know if it works, but in all my films, I do try my best to give people a sort of almost like a fictional layer that will keep them more entertained than they'd otherwise be in a documentary.
Well, it's interesting how everything always seems to come back to Star Trek. You know, it's like the idea of the library of the sky and the food that comes out, you push a button and tell the machine what you want, and it pops out immediately. But we do seem to be like wanting to become Star Trek all the time. Google in particular.
I'm not a Star Trek expert, because when I grew up...
This could be your next movie.
Well, when I grew up in the 70s in Britain, my dad would only let me watch a certain amount of American TV series a day, and these did not include Starsky and Hutch or Happy Days. And then every day, you know, I'd go to school, maybe I was like 7 or something, it's very early 70s, and what was the thing the fonts did? All the kids were talking about the fonts, hey! And I'd never seen the fonts do, hey! So I saw a bit of Star Trek, you know, but not enough for that to be a reference point. Like 2001 is certainly a reference point. You know, I've watched it 10 or 20 times. But
so the prohibition was only on American television? You watch all the British television you like, but
you had to kind of watch educational stuff. Yeah, I wasn't allowed to watch a lot of sort of British cop series either. Mm-hmm. So he wasn't an anti-American, you know.
He just, our junk was junkier than your junk.
There was definitely that. Yeah, I remember when Davils opened in the 70s in Golders Green, which is a sort of North London Jewish suburb very near to where I lived. Mm-hmm. And Davils is a sort of American ice cream place. You know they, you know that, don't you? They do lots.
No.
Okay, they don't exist anymore, but they were like Baskin Robbins,
uh-huh.
and they had like 32 flavors. And no one had
to
ever
avoid
had,
a lawsuit, apparently.
No one had ever had like an ice cream store in Britain that offered 32 flavors, but it was some big American thing. It was like McDonald's opening. And my dad took me along and he said, all right, well, I suppose we can try it, you know.
So was your exposure to something like 2001 or other movies from going to the movies, or did you see them on TV, or did it happen later in life? Were you always a movie person?
I've always been really, really into films and really, really into contemporary art and really, really into jazz. Like literally, like obsessively, like I've got like 3,000 jazz vinyl records from the 60s and 70s at home, and you know I saw
no record player.
No, yeah, I got sure I got two Technics.
The most expensive record players in the world now, yeah.
Well, I don't know. I used to DJ and stuff. I got record players, and these kind of things, especially like early 70s jazz fusion. It's quite space age, and you know I went to saw Blade Runner in the cinema when it came out. I must have been like a teenager, young teenager then, and. These things blew me away, but I've always been a, you know, big fan of science fiction. J.G. Ballard, Kubrick, Ridley Scott.
So how did you, I mean, why are you not a DJ?
Because it is very boring standing behind two record decks and playing music for 5 hours to an empty dance floor. Brackets, that means like logically, I wasn't a very good DJ. I had like the best records, but I didn't never put them on in the right order.
Okay, so you were never going to become Fatboy Slim. That was not in your future.
No, that wasn't. That was never going to happen. No.
So you'd just be playing bar mitzvahs at this point. Is that the?
Well, I used to DJ in Berlin in 1989 in little clubs, and
that
the wall was still
cool.
up.
That sounds really like a cool thing to do in 1989.
It was. I mean, generally, Berlin was pretty cool in 1989. It was a pretty cool place to be. I mean, a really cool place to be. And I was very lucky. I was very privileged to be able to sort of experience the Cold War. Effectively, in the middle of this town, in the middle of East Germany, in the middle of communism and stuff. And I was in West Berlin, but that influenced me, that place.
So how did you end up thinking being a documentarian would be a good idea?
Well, that's another good story. You see, I got a degree in art history, and I came back from Berlin. I'd had a scholarship to study in Berlin. I came back for a job in an art gallery, and the gallery owner had never really told me how much I was going to get paid. And he said, well, before tax, we're going to pay you like £7,000, which was at the time would be like $10,000 a year. And I said, I haven't spent 5 years in higher education at the best universities in the world to earn that kind of money. And suddenly the art world became for me, which is what it is a place where people with, you know, whose parents are very wealthy, where people whose parents are wealthy go to work. And
right.
And I just thought, you know, I'm into music and I'm young and I don't want to spend my life selling art to really rich people and I want to keep my love of art. And then I was a postman for 3 weeks and then I got offered a job at MTV. Writing MTV News.
How'd you end up being a postman for 3 weeks?
Because I believed in the work ethic, and I think that, you know, if you're unemployed, I mean, in that time, you know, I graduated from Cambridge and the Free University of Berlin, and these were really good universities, but I didn't know much about the world of work. But I do kind of think that, which I suppose is a good, almost like an American characteristic, that, you know, you go out to work and you take the best thing going, and that's what I did.
So if you weren't going to make a lot of money, you were going to at least get your hands dirty while doing it?
Yeah. I was going to, you know, participate in the economy somehow, yeah.
With an MTV called.
Then, yeah, exactly. Then I had someone at MTV knew me, and I spoke 4 European languages, and I had quite an expert knowledge on of funk music and house music and jazz, and that was, and I could write because of my degree. So they wheeled me in and got me to write MTV News for a few years.
Huh. And was that fun, or was that?
Well,
I mean, professional television is really its own thing.
No, I mean, MTV is probably the most stupid job you could ever have. It's like writing news in Gotham. You know, imagine living in Gotham City and writing the daily news. You know, it's a parallel world. Like, you know, world hunger is a subject of Jon Bon Jovi's latest single, MTV News has learned. You know, you'd have these sort of, you'd fake these scoops. And we had to be sort of regularly sacked because we wrote like these stories that got us into trouble with record labels. Like I remember one time Vanity Fair was running an article, ran a big story about fashions in plastic surgery. Mm-hmm. And then the next day, I and a very dear friend wrote a story that was read out live by the interview presenter, which began, "Michael Jackson is sporting last year's nose," according to a recent copy of Vanity Fair.
So they just say you're out for a day and then you come back and start writing another.
Jacko's management rang up and they were not pleased, and they were told that these two, you know, young, inexperienced, incompetent journalists have been fired.
So had you ended up not writing comedy for the BBC?
I'd have loved to. I don't think I really have much talent. A lot of the films I've made are actually comedies, uh-huh. but I've never really, I don't think I've ever exhibited that level of talent, to be honest with you. I wish I did, because I completely worship comedians, mm-hmm. and particularly like people like Steve Coogan. There's a brilliant British stand-up called Stuart Lee, mm-hmm. and if any of your viewers want to look at the front, you know, the cutting edge of British stand-up, look at Stuart Lee's videos on YouTube, because they're just magic. But I didn't do that. When I worked at MTV, I literally discovered that you could have a job in TV, mm-hmm. and then I literally discovered that there was a job, you know, called directing documentaries. And then I just, very simply, I just watched lots and lots and lots of documentaries, mm-hmm. on and on and on TV, anything, just, and tried to work out how they were done. And mm-hmm. in the same time, MTV was getting me to shoot interviews with pop stars, and I'd mm-hmm. shoot little sequences. And then I was doing sort of reportage, youth reportage around Europe and for MTV. And then that led me to Channel 4 and the BBC and 5-minute short films and 10-minute short films and half an hour films and hour long films. And, you know, I mean, I climbed a ladder quite slowly, and I bought lots of books on documentaries. That's how I learned how to make films. Hmm.
So then you became a filmmaker just because?
Yeah.
Step by step by step by step.
Well, the key to being a filmmaker is, yeah, I think you have to learn how to do it. But also you have to have stories that, you know, people want to listen to you telling.
But you're not a kid who went out with a digital camera for the first time and said, I must be a documentarian. It sounds like you worked your way through a lot of interesting things to get to where...
It just wasn't my generation, you know. I mean, when Hi8 cameras came around in the 90s, I did get off my butt. And like, I was doing a film about environmental protesters, and I did get off my butt and go and shoot a bit with them early in the morning. But, mm-hmm. you know, in that sense, I like really admire people who actually take a camera and do it all themselves. I didn't do that. I worked my way mm-hmm. through a system.
So know. When did the Google effort to digitize every book come to your life as an idea?
Well, you know, like it was like 4 years ago, I started to think, I don't know why people have this sort of blind faith in the internet. There's a kind mm-hmm. of religious zeal with which people regard technology now, and they think it's going to make, you know, create, improve our economy, mm-hmm. you know, the long tail, all information is going to be free, it's going to make us cleverer, Lawrence Lessig, free culture, mm-hmm. you know, we're all going to get all the art and music and books and whatever we want for free, no one can charge for it anymore, and the world is going to become more democratic, and it's going to help revolutions, and land of, it's like, you know, land of hope and glory. It's just, it's crazy shit.
Yes. Yeah,
and it's like a religion. And I just thought I would really like to make a film that critiques or gets people to question whether they are putting too much faith in the internet. And there's a mm-hmm. phrase for this. It's called techno-utopianism. Mm-hmm. And I looked around for a story for 2 years, and it was difficult to find one. You know, there was an obvious story you could do about copyright and illegal downloading and music, you know, music right. and films. But it's really difficult to look at these issues through that subject, because basically it means that millions of anonymous teenagers are criminals. Mm-hmm. And it also means that you're, inverted commas, siding with record companies. And I think that's a very difficult position to be in as a filmmaker.
Yeah.
You know.
Or as a human being having a conversation at dinner. It's... You know, people, you'll do see the record companies, the movie studios and everything as kind of these monolithic, wealthy entities that you don't really, it's okay to steal from them because they're
yeah.
not humane.
But books were different. You know, we have a sort of, you know, we revere books, and we know it takes a long time to write a book, and we know it's really difficult. We know writers don't make a lot of money. And we know that a kind of book is a complete entity. And we, you know, there's such a regard in our culture for knowledge. And here was a story that involved not millions of anonymous teenagers and music, but it involved books and writers and Google. You know, and also, I should say, also other large corporations or public entities that were doing digital book scanning projects,
right.
Which, you know, include Microsoft and includes Amazon and includes Brewster Kahle's Internet Archive. And I just thought this is like such a brilliant story, you know, and it's so unbelievable, like create the Universal Digital Library and it's kind of fixed in everyone's minds. And I can tell, a really remarkable story about the internet that uses the Google book story as a central thread. But through that story, you know, you'll be able to examine lots and lots of themes. On the one hand, the dreams of the internet, on the other hand, the dangers. And I could make a film that kept people watching and engaging with the subject without demonizing Google or demonizing the internet.
So what was your process? Do you start with research? Do you start with years of research, hours of research?
Yeah, well, this film took years of research. I mean, years and years and years. Uh-huh. I mean, I've been asked a lot, what did you discover as you made this film? And I did discover something I can tell you later, but let's just say for the sake of it that not every film is a journey of discovery. And if you're going to try and raise $500,000 to make a documentary, you need to have, or you should possibly have, a damn good idea of what story you're going to tell, right? Not just to persuade people to give you the money, but because that's right. Quite a lot of trust. It's public money that people are giving me, and I need to be sure that I'm using it wisely. So yeah, tons and tons and tons of reading and considering all kinds of stories. And what clinched it for me was in March 2011, when the Google Book Settlement, this agreement between Google and authors and publishers, was rejected. Because a judge had basically thrown out the Google Book scanning project as it had been conceived. You can't carry on like this, you know. Too many copyright issues involved, too many economic monopoly issues involved. Sorry, this is just not going to work. And then it had a sort of ending. So I had a story about how the net was changed by a group, you know, by a valiant group of people. Authors, you know, and some publishers and some world governments. And in the end, American Department of Justice. You know, it began as a little thing with authors and it built into this campaign, and Google were effectively stopped. Although, you know, they're going to create a marvelous digital library one day in the future. Things will carry on, but they won't carry on as they were.
Well, everybody will figure out how to monetize in a different way, I think. I think it's the reality. And I think a lot of people are still grappling with that. I mean, we had a big controversy in America. The New York Times took it up through David Carr that, you know, about how evil Amazon was, and that the whole movement towards ebooks was so destructive to authors and the prices. But the reality is the market changes, and you know, they may have a bit, who knows where it'll be in 10 years, but you know, it probably won't be on $18 hardbacks.
Well,
which is where they all made such a ton of money.
Yeah, it won't be that, you know, but we can all influence the way this economy develops. And as far as the internet goes, we have to watch out that, you know, when you give millions and millions of people something for free, you're not taking that thing for free from the little guy without paying him.
Right.
You've got to watch out for that. You know, we tend to think about you know, our economy in terms of, you know, consumers, making sure consumers get a fair deal, but you've also got to make sure the producers get a fair deal.
Well, it's an interesting thing, I think. I mean, you don't get into it as much, but the ultimate thing of copyright and the limitations on copyright are now, to me, seem very antiquated. Like the idea, because the idea that something would live 80 years or be of value for 80 years was a long time 100 years ago or 200 years ago, but now seems like the beginning. It doesn't seem like, you know, there's any end to the point where you should theoretically be able to own your work, because it will be exploited forever. You know, there's not an end game.
I mean, yeah. I mean, there's different positions on copyright, aren't there?
Yeah.
And the general argument is that, you know, artists should be able to take, you know, benefit financially from their work for sort of 70 years or so after, and their estate and, you know, their children should be able to also benefit from their work for sort of 50, 60, 70 years. But after that, you know, it's art, it should go into the public domain. That's a kind of compromise. I mean, I'm prepared to accept that, but it does make you wonder, maybe they should apply the same laws to property.
Right.
Supposing this house we're in, supposing your children were allowed to live in this house 50 years or 60 years after you died, and after that, tough luck, it got taken away from
the family. Yeah.
And resold.
Absolutely. Because it did come from the state in the first place, theoretically.
Yeah.
But yeah. Because it's not, I mean, it's the same thing, I guess, with people who lived to be, you know, in their 50s or 60s at the latest, that it was, you know, the rules that governed people's, the extension of people's lives just became irrelevant, as we're finding now with the insurance, health insurance, and, you know, other things that are paying out over many years and continue to grow and eat the economy in the United States of America. It's just impossible to catch up with it. So you knew kind of where you were going as you actually started production of this movie.
Yeah, sure. I had a list of themes, had a list of interviewees. You know, I had the story. I kind of knew the beginning, the middle, and the end of the story.
Did anything significant change, or was it?
Well, what happens when you interview and film the story, different themes come to the fore. And what happened was, you know, we had on our list the topic of AI, you know, artificial intelligence. Because in the course of my reading, I'd sort of come across the story of IBM supercomputer Watson. Mm. You know, and Watson was a supercomputer built by IBM after they sort of won at chess with their chess supercomputer, Deep Blue. They built Watson, and basically they got Watson to read the whole of Wikipedia and lots of encyclopedias, and then they entered it as a competitor in the quiz game Jeopardy. And their software was so good, this computer had absorbed so many facts, and it could process, memorize so much information accurately that it won at Jeopardy. Mm-hmm.
Which we see in the movie.
Yeah, you see that in the movie, and it's like, and I was like, oh my God, well, I wonder, you know, I know Google and these other companies, they want to collect masses and masses of data because it's, you know, useful today, but it will also have an unquantifiable use tomorrow. That's one of the things that makes internet companies really smart, is that they do stuff because they think tomorrow they might understand why they're doing it. That's how far ahead you've got to be in this game. Mm-hmm. That's true. You know, these people are so far, thinking so far ahead, they're so smart that they're prepared to accept, like they're prepared to do something because they don't know why they're doing it.
Well, anyway. It's fascinating because there is also a things become, you know, phased out the same way. People who think invest very heavily in these companies, as you see in the internet all the time, and then the stuff just disappears as they change the, you know, the plug. From one to the other. Anyway, sorry.
No, it's fine. So anyway, I figured, well, maybe they're scanning all these books because of something to do with, like, building a, you know, creating something intelligent, you know, AI. Maybe that, because Wikipedia is quite basic. So what about books?
Right.
That was a sort of thesis that, and there was a few lines in books that made you think, you know, about history of the internet and Google and stuff that made you think that could be a big story. Mm-hmm. But when the course of my filming, when I interviewed, you know, people like Kevin Kelly and Ray Kurzweil, who are really close to the Google people, you know, I was amazed when I put that question to them and they said, yeah, that's what Google's founders told us they wanted to do. Mm. They want to build AI, Ben. Mm-hmm. And if you want a really smart AI, then books are pretty important. That was definitely something I learned.
So I can't let you do that, Dave, is just around the corner somewhere. That's what they'd like. The computer HAL and HAL 9000 and the 2001.
Yeah.
That's what they have in mind, ultimately?
Well, there are two kinds of AI. I never quite know the terminology. There's like weak AI, I think, and true AI, or soft AI and hard AI. Now, the lower down version, which is what, you know, Watson would be a computer that has memorized billions of human decisions, bits of knowledge that we have. And what the computer does is it repeats what it knows we've done. And there's that, the same principle, I think, as I understand it, applies to a lot of what the Google self-driving car is about.
Right.
So they memorize stuff, and then the trick is for the computer to instantly access the correct decision that a human being has made at some point in the past.
Yeah.
That would be weak AI, and then the sort of true AI would be when the computer would start thinking for itself.
Which is a little bit scary.
Yeah, just a little bit.
Is that another movie, do you think?
I think I would be very happy to make a film about AI, and I haven't seen a documentary yet about the history of AI.
Mm-hmm. So was this in terms of actually making this film, a hard film to make, or did you find it came to you pretty easily?
No, it's really, 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 really hard to make. But I just feel, as a documentary filmmaker, if I sit here and tell you that my film was a nightmare to make, it's like I'm a sort of narcissist who lives in his own bubble, because don't you know that every documentary film you make, you like die to make? And you know, you die to make it. Firstly, because like you don't earn a lot of money out of these things. And so I suppose also because you love your subject. And then, you know, there's just let's face it, there's the ambition factor. Like, maybe if I really put every single bit of energy and thought and time I can into this film, maybe I'll get to Sundance. I mean, you know, I'm not the only guy who makes films or woman who makes films who thinks like that.
How's it going for you?
Well, it's lovely here. It's lovely here. I mean, it's... There are moments when it feels a bit pressured, because what they do is, they, as a documentary filmmaker, they turn you into a sort of like a proper feature film director filmmaker, like you're a really important person, and you you know, there's photo opportunities, and I get photographed by Getty Wire, and you know, you go down carpets, and it's and it's nothing like, you know, going to most other documentary film festivals, which is sort of, you know, full of very poor grubby people who love making films and drink beer and whatever. So there's a sort of glamorous thing to it, and you think, oh yeah, wow, I've really made it. And then you sort of remember how little you are, and then it gets a bit pressured. So there's that to it. But yeah, I mean, the film was like you make this a film like Google, this Google and the World Brain film, and you work really, really, really hard at it. And then one day you dial up Google and you say, I'm making this film about Google Books. And you think they're going to say, great, yeah, you're a BBC director, I don't mind talking to you. And you've got a good track record, and you know, we can see your films, we know you're going to be decent. And then they just say, I'm sorry, we can't talk to you about books. It's too controversial and we're marred in legal action. And you're halfway into production, you're like, oh my God, I never thought that would happen. How do I make the film? Shit. And then you have to sort of, you know, it's constantly like that.
It's kind of funny because we've had a bunch of people who did films in this festival, documentarians, who didn't interview the quote unquote subject or the center of the film. You know, it's an unusual circumstance. We just had the folks who made Citizen Coke in here who did not interview the Coke brothers in the film. And one after the other, there are a lot of these films this year that didn't have the access to the person at the center of the story, but still tell the story very effectively.
Yeah.
It's challenging.
It's challenging. I think you've probably got to accept that nowadays.
So what did you have to add to the film to make it work without Google?
Well, we did get an interview with Google in America. We were only allowed to talk about search with them, and that was, you know, a component of the film. In a way, that was the broader framework.
Yeah.
So that was okay. They did give us that.
But that guy saying no was kind of part of the film also. Of talking about other things, or kind of like giving you the flowery version of how he saw Google.
Well, yes. I mean, it wasn't the right decision on their part not to talk to us about books, because as you know from the film, it's not a demolition job on Google at all. I've got you know, masses of respect for what they try to do, and I think it's probably useful for a company that's that dynamic to take a bit of criticism and learn from that. And there's lots of people in the film who think Google are amazing and everything. But you're right that interview is a bit too evangelical, really, for its own good.
Yeah.
And people can see through it.
It's pretty clear that he's on, you know, a team.
He's a little well rehearsed, isn't it?
Yeah.
It's just a little well rehearsed.
Well, that's the job of being a corporate person, I guess, is that, you know, you got to go out there and say the right thing.
Can be counterproductive, though, can't it?
It can be, if you have a clever director who's got the footage.
I think generally you've got to be open to the media and give them permission to criticize you. I mean, as a filmmaker, you know, I've done interviews this week, and before the interviewer says to me, is there anything you don't want me to ask you? I'm like, WTF? ? I'm a journalist and a filmmaker, and I believe in the values of free society. And you can ask me anything you want, and you know, you can tell me you don't like my film, and I will take it all, because it's your job. You know, this time I'm in the chair, you're the media, it's your job to interrogate me exactly as you see fit. And I think, I generally think, like, you know, big corporations would benefit by taking that approach, actually.
Well, yeah, hiding is never a good idea. It always makes you seem guilty and defensive, so
yeah,
there's never a positive outcome to that, I don't think.
No.
Or at least very rarely. I guess they're always hoping it'll go away and you won't end up in Sundance. They're kind of hoping you'll end up at home watching it on videotape in your own living room.
Yeah, and we can all survive a bit of bad criticism, can't we? I mean, my career's survived a few bad reviews.
So what's your most hated film?
Oh, God, I can't tell you that on camera. That would be going too far. Didn't I tell you before the interview you're not allowed to ask that question?
Well, the funny thing about this format is the whole idea is to really be conversational. So I don't need to embarrass anybody for the sake of embarrassing them. If the subject is relevant, I'll bring it up. But but when people start asking, you realize the talent brings it up much more often than than I ever would. You know,
right?
We've spoken to people this week, and there were things that I thought were maybe perhaps sensitive for issues for them, and they talk about them, they like bring it up first. They're in the rush to get it out of the way, and then it's like, okay, you've won. They've won by actually embracing the fact that they know that people were interested in the subject that you might think they were sensitive about. So,
well, it must be something to do with you being very warm and jovial and inviting them into the comfort of your home.
It's the ultimate seduction of the house. Or sometimes we bring out the strippers, depending on the you know, which the interview is. If we have agents, we definitely always strippers. That's become a theme of Sundance this year.
I think I'd find that very distracting.
Oh, looking around, got to find the strippers. So this has been a great experience for you, coming to Sundance with a
phone. Yeah, sure. You know, they say that when you die, you see the whole of your life kind of flash before you. And at my world premiere, I learned that they were here in Sundance. I learned that there were sort of deemed to be more than one moment when you see the whole of your life flash before you. Because, you know, you do spend, I have spent like 20 years in a way working up to this. And I never expected this film to get shown in Sundance in a billion years. I mean, some people make films from a position of confidence, but it's just, that's just not me, you know.
So will you go, what will you take away from it?
From here?
Yeah.
I think, you know what, I can tell you exactly what I'll really take away from here, the confidence to carry on, because it's really, really difficult, right, to get funding in Europe, in Britain and Europe now, to make films about complicated and really intelligent subjects about how the world is changing now. It's really difficult. If you say to a commissioning editor, all our films tend to be funded by TV channels,
right,
and if you go to most commissioning editors, not all of them, because my film got off the ground, but if you go to most commissioning editors in Europe, you say, I want to make a film about a story that no one has heard before, not many people have heard of. It's a really complicated subject. It's very, very, very topical. They sort of go, oh, I'm sorry, that's not right for our target audience. I mean, it's really difficult. It took 2 years to get this film funded. And when you come here, you realize that Sundance is part of is actually helping to build. I mean, there are other organizations, institutions involved, but
right,
Sundance is key. It's helping to build an alternative power structure for documentary filmmaking, different from the castle of power of the world's TV channels. And that Sundance is here so that when I come up with an idea, the TV channels or whomever my funders might be are not going to turn around to me, I'm sorry, and say, I'm sorry, Ben, that's not a reality TV format. I'm not interested. Or,
right,
I'm sorry, who's your presenter talent? They're not going to say that. They're just going to say, this is a good idea. I can see your track record. I want you to try and do this.
So that's a good thing.
Very good thing.
And how many films have you made?
You know what? I've made at least 10. I've made tons and tons. I've made because
over how many years was that?
Oh God! The last 15 years, I made a film investigating the contemporary art market that bust Damien Hirst's butt and is absolutely notorious in the art world.
I've seen that piece.
Yeah, called The Great Contemporary Art Bubble. I made a cult series about contemporary art that were all comedies called Art Safari. I made a film about the history of communism told through communist jokes, all the jokes people told who lived under those regimes, called Hammer and Tickle. I made a film about Ceausescu, about the Romanian communist dictator, but from the perspective of all the art and the spectacular stage shows his regime created. I made a film about Baader Meinhof, the terrorists, and you can see clips of all my films on my website. I mean, benlewis.tv. There's lots and lots of clips if anyone's interested. Okay. And the list goes on. I don't want to bore you, sorry.
No, you sound kind of prolific.
Prolific as I can be. You know, I've had my downtime.
But not working at the post office anymore.
I haven't had to go back to working at the post office, no.
So you're a full-fledged documentarian. That is your life at this point. You found your place.
Well, I mean, I write as an art critic as well. I'm a published author. But nowadays, I seem to spend most of my time making documentaries. Yeah, a vegetarian documentarian.